Here in the 06010, never gonna hustle, in case you didn't know. Matthew Berry, TMR.
You guys go ahead, give me grief for being on SportsCenter for 45 seconds.
I think you could do better than me, because I don't think you could.
Jail bait, field yate.
You're terrible at hashtag improv.
At field yate. At field yate.
Stefania Bell.
Oh, don't let Barry convert you.
Secret squirrel, Daniel Dodd.
Make it happen.
Mediocre fantasy advice.
You're older than people realize.
That never stops.
Loyal 06010 listeners.
Welcome in to the Monday, April 30th edition of the Fantasy Focus Football Podcast. It's the post-draft extravaganza. It's Yates with Matthew Berry. Hello, sir.
What's up?
What's up, father?
Life's good.
Life
is good. Very exciting. Nice to see Stefania finally joining us. No secret squirrel
Hello,
today.
Stefania.
He's off on a boondoggle.
You know what? Matthew gets so excited when he beats anyone to anything ever because it's so rare that you're here in advance. I know.
Today.
You know right. what? Did you give him like a little treat so that like it's Pavlovian so like he'll keep coming back? You got to reinforce the good behavior.
The three of us have somewhere to be after the show. Tonight, we're driving to New York City, the three of us together in a car.
What could go wrong?
The people that are putting this on, God forbid, they get a separate car service. They want us to spend all every minute of every waking day together. But we have this car service that's coming to pick us up at 2:30 to take us to New York City, where we will make a big announcement about the 06010. So I'm excited
cool.
for everyone
yep.
to hear about what that is. If you follow us on social media, I'm sure you'll learn about it later tonight, or certainly when we do our show next. But the fact of the matter is, Field Yates, is that we have the plan. We know where we're supposed to be picked up, and yet Starfania already like, can you have the car? Pick me up at DC2 because I have to get my shoes. She's got a different pair of shoes, Field Yates, as opposed to you and I are both going to be picked up where the car service normally picks all the ESPN talent up, right?
In
the
Correct. Circle. That's a plan.
Right. In the
you
circle in front of in building
what,
four.
What shoes are you wearing? You're wearing flat shoes.
That's right.
I'm going to wear heels, and this is a big campus, and we run around on campus, and I'm going to go and get my
I get
high
it. You're
heels.
Not in shape. I understand. It's all good, Starfania. I understand.
Wow.
It's fine.
I can't wait till we have feats of strength later this summer, and I'm going to kick your behind.
How heavy are the shoes that you couldn't bring them with you? You couldn't carry them? You're wearing whatever. What are you? You're in flats right now?
I also have a leather jacket, which I got to
carry. Oh, okay. I'm sorry. I didn't realize that. Starfania.
And I'm not going to bring everything that I brought to the podcast.
Field, do you think the sign on the car will say, Starfania Bell, also writing, Field Yates, Matthew Berry?
I have no doubt.
Rewind. Fantasy news from the National Football League.
This is the instant replay.
I have no doubt as well. It's an interesting week for us, Field Yates.
Yes, it is, Matthew. It is the summit week here at ESPN, our fantasy football summit, which we conduct every year right after the NFL draft. And basically, this is the unofficial kickoff to the upcoming season. So we will start to set ranks for the 2018 season. We'll have thoughtful conversations, discussions, debates, some spirited. Some
I'm going to throw down. I don't know who but
yeah, with who?
I don't know. I gotta basically wait because it's the entire ESPN fantasy crew
plus
cast
more.
And crew plus more.
We
so I mean, right?
Invited
so
invited.
So in addition,
guests.
Right? It's you know. So it's what it's Carabelle. It's Tristan. It's Mike Clay. It's Al Zeidenfeld. It's Ken Dobby. It's Casey
Tom
Joyner.
Carpenter, yep.
Tom Carpenter. Todd Zola. Like
Andre
everyone.
Snelling.
Like
yep.
right. Andre Snelling. Right. The whole cast and crew. Everyone, including like not. Cool Keith and Kyle Soppy and Damien,
yeah,
who you've never heard of. Like a lot
That's
of people
a good
on
nickname.
The right. and so all these people behind the scenes, in front of the camera as well.
Secret
all,
Squirrel may even
Secret
come back
Squirrel
and join
might,
us for
might,
that.
Might come by.
I don't I don't know. He's such a big celebrity.
He's entitled to like 11 weeks of vacation now. So.
But like, you know, our insiders, guys like Adam Schefter and Mike Triplett and like a lot
the great
of people.
Matt Bowen will be
right,
there.
Matt Bowen will be
We've
the
named
right.
everybody.
So it's a huge thing. It's a company-wide thing. And we all get together. And so I just got to see which, when everyone walks in, I just got to see which guy I can take. I just got to look around and like, who's the oldest and feeblest out there?
It might be a short list. It might be you.
It might be you, Stefania. I got to be honest with you. And to be honest, I'm not sure I could take you.
No,
you're in
no,
very
no,
good
no.
shape. Jokes aside, you're actually in very good shape. But so I have to figure out someone that I could take. But beyond that, Field, what will be interesting is this week, the company is just like, we're all in.
Yeah,
the Ranking Summit has usually been just sort of like us locked in a room, and maybe a video here or there trickles out. But this week we're going to have tons of. We'll have a new podcast out of the Ranking Summit.
We do.
We will have there'll be lots of clips that you'll see on SportsCenter, on NFL Live, on ESPN Plus.
Yep.
You will see on the fantasy app as well. So tons and tons of stuff. Not Cool Keith has literally spent the last 2.5 months putting this all together. And I can't wait to just make a complete mess of it.
No, it's going to be great. The end result of this is, as we said, it gets our ranking set for the 2018
yep.
season. Understanding a player signing here, a trade there, an injury there could alter all those rankings. However, it's a great starting point for us. And as you said, Matthew, there's going to be content aplenty. Since we have so much of that to get
to. It's a content palooza.
Content palooza.
It's a content palooza is what it is. That's
it's got a nice
rolls,
ring to it.
I was going to say, it rolls right off your
it
tongue.
Really,
rolls
it really
right
does.
Off the tongue. So there will be plenty of content throughout the week. In the meantime, let's get to some content for today and begin. And we're going to do this by position.
Sure.
And we're going to start with the two that are most fantasy relevant, we would say, in running back and wide receiver. Of course, this is a draft special. So there's been some other moves that have taken place that will be addressed, will be baked into the fantasy summit content. But for now, let's get to the draft.
Yeah, we'll talk about a couple of couple moves here. But
we'll start with the running backs. And of course, this might not just be the most important player amongst running backs. I think this is easily the most discussed rookie going into the year. It's Saquon Barkley, the unsurprising number 2 overall pick in the NFL draft, the New York Giants. Matthew, I don't know why we have to overthink this. The question is not like, can he be effective? Is he fantasy relevant? It's how high in the draft are you taking Saquon Barkley? That's the immediate question people are asking.
I put this out on Twitter yesterday where I said I would be shocked if he gets past pick 15 in any draft.
Shocked. I thought you were going to say 10. To be honest, I
have no issue with him being taken in the first round. I think he will be ranked. Somewhere between, I actually have him as running back 5. So
okay.
I'm pretty high on him.
Yep.
And I think you'll see people, I haven't looked at anyone else's ranks. My guess is people will rank him somewhere between, I'd be very surprised if anyone ranked him higher than 5. I'd be very, very shocked if
the range is like 5 to 12 in the rankings.
That's
which
what I
right.
would, that sounds about right to me. I was going to say somewhere in there. And so I think you're looking at, so running back 5 to 12, depending on whose ranks you trust and, also, let's be, you know, and what scoring system you're in. You know, look, is he a first rounder in a 2-quarterback league? I doubt that.
Yep.
Right? And I think he would go, believe it or not, I think he goes lower in standard than he would in PPR.
Yeah.
I think he's going to be a monster PPR running back. My ranks are based on PPR. Why have him 5? You think about just being in a Pat Shurmur offense field. Last year in Minnesota, Vikings running backs over 100 targets. They were second in rushing percentage. While with the Vikings, 6th in red zone rushing percentage. This is Pat Shurmur, of course. And you look back also at his time when he was with Philadelphia, they were top 6 in terms of red zone rush percentage as well. Like being a running back in a Pat Shurmur offense, it's a good thing.
It's a good thing. There's only one limiting factor here for Saquon Barkley. They signed Jonathan Stewart, and over the draft weekend, GM Dave Gettleman said, you know, Jonathan, I think his quote was along the lines of, Jonathan Stewart is a 10-year running back who hasn't lost a step, which obviously if you watch Jonathan Stewart, you could tell he's lost many steps.
Right.
But just the idea that Jonathan Stewart could handle 40% of the goal line carries, is that an unreasonable estimate? 35%?
That sounds a little bit high to me. Look, if Gettleman was the head coach, I would agree with you. I think Pat Shurmur is going to try to just get it into the end zone. I understand. Listen, do I think Stewart steals some goal line work from Barkley? I do.
I think if they're lining up short yardage, that's where I see Jonathan Stewart being the most useful. But how often are they going to be in that situation? I think Saquon Barkley is the playmaker. That he's going to be the predominant back. I think Jonathan Stewart fell in my rankings as soon as the Saquon Barkley signing happened.
Sure.
Because I think that if they... Here's the other thing I would point out. The Panthers were, just excellent at managing Jonathan Stewart's health.
Yep.
If he's not with the Panthers, I don't think he's still playing football right now. And so if the Giants don't manage him similarly, that could be an issue.
Maybe a good news, too. I was just thinking about this. I'm sort of talking myself out of my own argument. Is last year, Dalvin Cook gets drafted by the Vikings. They had signed Latavius Murray to a three-year deal worth about $15 million if he hit maximum value. Latavius Murray, in the first four games of last season, here were his yards and his carries. 2 rushes, 6 yards, 3 rushes, 6 yards, 2 rushes, 5 yards, 7 rushes, 21 yards. Obviously, Dalvin Cook gets hurt, and next thing you know, Latavius Murray becomes a real player.
But
and
Latavius Murray was
right?
hurt. Yeah, and he was not. He did not do much in training camp, so I don't think he was 100% at the start of the season.
He may
either.
Have been a little bit behind the eight ball there in terms, new system, new team, everything like that. But I think your point is well taken here, Field Yates. Saquon Barkley is going to touch the ball a ton. And I mean, look, he's 230 pounds. Like, he's not some small guy. Like, there's no reason to pull him at the goal line either.
He's virtually without flaw. That's the bottom line. I mean, I understand you can debate, and I would have that debate with people about whether it's worth taking a running back number two overall. But if you're going to do it, this is the kind of player that you do it on.
And also, I think just as a Giants fan, you have to be excited. When you think about this offense, look, I'm no Eli fan at this stage of his career, but a healthy Beckham, Sterling Shepard, Evan Ingram. I mean, those are a lot of guys spreading the field and opening it up. And then just Barkley, such a good pass catcher out of the backfield, just a ton of dump offs, which is a staple of the Pat Shurmur offense. Like I said, I'm at five. Apparently, Thirsty Kyle just texted me. Jim McCormick, our colleague Jim McCormick, has him ranked fourth.
Okay.
In fairness, Jim McCormick's crazy. But, I mean, it just goes to show you how high it is. My suspicion is, I love Jim. By the end of August, I think the hype on Barkley is going to be so high. I would not be surprised to see him going in the first round in most drafts.
No question about that. I'll just be honest. I will probably be a little bit slow to roll just because on a lot of these rookies, only because add a little bit more context, put the pads on, and then I will move them up my ranks as we get closer to the season.
I would say the one thing is we've already talked about this position tends to be the position where you can have the most impact right away as running backs. Like, they're best, they're when they're youngest. That's when they're healthiest. That's when, and most of them, if they've already shown that they're a versatile running back, and he's built a lot like Ezekiel Elliott, and Ezekiel Elliott came in and had an impact right away. Like, I think Saquon Barkley is somebody who has an impact right away, and at that position he has the ability to do it.
And they address their offensive line issues as well in the very next round. So I mean, the Giants still have a long way to go, and it's going to be a very tough division. I mean, but that division, by the way, probably the best running backs in that division in football.
I mean, it's just a terrific running back division. We'll talk about another rookie that could make an impact in just a second. But before we do that, we've got some big news. In the last 2 weeks, Simply Safe won the Editor's Choice Awards from CNET Magazine, PC Magazine, and The Wirecutter. These are three massively respected product testers. They put Simply Safe through a battery of tests compared to other home security products, and Simply Safe won every time. Hands down, Simply Safe is the best home security system out there. They protect over 2 million Americans. This is a home security system you actually want in your home. The sensors are tiny. You won't notice them. And it's unbelievably easy to use. You can control it right from your phone. That's pretty sweet. But here's the most important reason. This isn't a gadget. It's a comprehensive protection for all your windows, your doors, your entire home. 24 hours a day, 365 days a year. The professional alarm monitoring there is there for you around the clock. It's just $15 a month. No contracts. No one else is doing it like this. Learn more about how Simply Safe can help protect your home. Just go to simplysafe.com/football. That's simplysafe.com/football. Next up on the running backs was arguably the most surprising pick in the first round. As a matter of fact, two players went in the back end of the first round that were massive surprises. One of them, Terrell Edmunds, Steelers safety, not so fantasy relevant. But Rashad Penny goes 27th overall to Seattle. I got to be honest. There were people who were asking me, who was Rashad Penny? I thought it was supposed to be Darius Geis who was supposed to go next, or Sony Michel, or Nick Chubb who was supposed to go next amongst the running backs. Once you get past the sort of sticker shock of Rashad Penny going in the first round, let's dig deeper. For those who may not know a whole bunch about him, last year the Eagles used Donnell Pumphrey, their fourth round pick last year, San Diego State,
who
was the predecessor to Rashad Penny at San Diego State.
Right. Very different running back. Pumphrey's like a little guy. Like he's a Sproles kind of guy. Like
yes.
Pumphrey's like a, I mean, he was a beast. You know what I mean? Like he was unbelievable in college. But,
right.
But
at San Diego State. And then Rashad Penny follows it up. And the thing about Pumphrey that was so surprising was his production was out of control.
Yeah.
And then Penny came in and just like completely blew it out of the water. He was unreal this past year. Had like, I believe, over, I think he had 20 touchdowns. Like, he was nuts. Great return man as well. Matthew, put that all aside, whether he should have been a first-round pick or not, it's actually a pretty generous fantasy position to land in Seattle.
Yeah, I mean, opportunity's obviously wide open there. You know, C.J. Procise has struggled to stay on the field. Chris Carson, who I loved last year, struggled to get onto the field because they were screwing around with Eddie Lacy and Thomas Rawls. And then when they finally realized Chris Carson's the best running back they have and they give the kid a shot, poor guy, he broke his leg, right, Stefania?
Yeah, broke his leg and a high ankle sprain, like a fracture and a bad sprain. It was a bad injury.
So it's wide open there. And then you think about the Seahawks offense, right? New offense coordinator Brian Schottenheimer, who has been traditionally run first in his career as an NFL play caller. No Paul Richardson, no Jimmy Graham. So you've got sort of, could they be going more run heavy? Getting back to
the roots,
if you will, of how the team was back in the Marshawn Lynch heyday and, you know, the 1 year with Rawls. And so the opportunity is certainly there. The talent is there. Rashad Penny is somebody that, you know, we've talked about, I believe on the draft, when we did our rookie preview,
like the post combine,
rookie podcast. We had Mike Clay on. I believe Mike referred to him as this year's Kareem Hunt.
Interesting.
That we did that, and so he's an extremely elusive back. Now, if you want a couple of red flags, wasn't a huge pass catcher out of at San Diego State, and then you think about in terms of, you know, how well does he fit this scheme? In 2017, Rashad Penny, 94% of his carries came with the quarterback under center. Last year, 60% of Seattle's runs came from under center when Russell Wilson was under center. So, you know, how much of a scheme fit is he? They'll figure that out. They'll design that. You don't use a first round pick to be like, whatever, especially given all the needs that Seattle has. So I'm very excited about Rashad Penny. I think this is a good fit. I understand the concerns about the offensive line in Seattle, and they've got to get that figured out. But again, his elusiveness and the elusiveness of Russell Wilson keeps defenses on its heel. We've seen this time after time again. A running back with a mobile quarterback is actually helpful for the run game.
No doubt about that. I mean, the question I think people are having is, as it pertains to Penny, do they draft him because they have not cut bait on the other running backs in place, but has their patience run dry with, for example, a player like Chris Carson, Stefania, who we thought last year was done. We knew, or we expected him to be done. And then Pete Carroll kind of opened up the door to him returning, which felt more like fiction, but it felt like more of a pipe dream than a reality.
If you've watched the Seahawks and you've heard Pete Carroll before, you know that this has happened. I mean, sometimes he projects optimism, sometimes overly optimistic about what a player's health status is. We've seen that before.
Yep.
So I think we took it with a grain of salt in December, but at least it bodes well for him being ready by the start of the season. That being said, there was no running back who could stay on the field for Seattle. They definitely had issues there. So maybe because Rashad Penny has done kick returns before, maybe there's some potential versatility there.
Could also be one of these things where, I mean, they clearly like him as an athlete. Again, this is a guy that, like, when you watch the college tape, sort of jumps off the field. 5'11", 220 pounds. But also, just given all the injuries they've had at the position, they're like, we just need more bodies. You know,
they were at a point last year where they had, like, no depth.
No depth whatsoever. And I think they do like Mike Davis, and they still like Chris Carson, who's a young guy there. I think they're hoping to get something out of they're hoping to get something out of, you know, Procise eventually. J.D. McKissick had flashes last year. Yep. But certainly the opportunity field is there for him to have a significant workload on a pretty good offense. So that makes him fantasy relevant. I will tell you, in my initial ranks, I had Penny as running back 23.
Yeah, that's about where I had him as well. The Patriots used their second of two first-round picks on Sony Michel out of Georgia. They actually double-dipped on Georgia players in the first round, drafting Isaiah Wynn, his left tackle, earlier on in the proceedings. Sony Michel now joins a backfield that includes Rex Burkhead, James White, and then I would suppose to a lesser degree, Jeremy Hill and also Mike Gillisley.
I would be surprised if both Gillisley and Hill make this team.
Correct. I think it's probably one spot for the two of those players. But in the meantime, Michelle, people are wondering, Matthew, and I think you got this question already, it says, you know, like, where does he fit in? Who is that? Does that mean that somebody between Michelle, Burkhead, and White is going to be rendered useless for fantasy or for their offense, period, given the fact that all of them are capable pass catchers?
Potentially. I mean, it's interesting. So there's so much to unravel with the Patriots, right? And so, you know, Bill Belichick scoffs at our fantasy needs. Yes. Obviously, he's just out there trying to win games. And anytime you try to predict the Patriots or say, this is what the Patriots are going to do, that's when you start looking stupid.
Right.
Or stupider in my particular case, by the way. So I have Sony Michel ranked the highest of all the Patriots running backs. I think he has the most touchdown potential. I think if we're sitting here a year from now, it would not shock me if we said, wow, Sony Michel had 15 touchdowns. It also wouldn't shock me if we said he had seven. Mm-hmm. Like, I mean, I just think there's a wide range there. This is a team that likes to run when they get in close. To your point, they've improved their offensive line. But this is, you know, the Patriots led the NFL in rushing, red zone rushing attempts last year.
Yep.
Right? I mean, you think about Deion Lewis, who obviously is no longer there. He's a member of the Titans. Deion Lewis tied for eighth in terms of running back red zone carries. He was fourth in red zone rushing yards. Burkhead vultured a number of touchdowns when he was healthy as well. So the opportunity is there, but there's a lot of factors going on, and not the least of which is the trust of Tom Brady. Having him back there, being able to pick up blitz, will he learn their, how quickly can he learn their offense and earn Tom's trust? Obviously, he has tremendous amount of faith in James White, who is still going to be the passing down back.
Yep.
And we saw what Rex Burkhead could do. Like I said, I have Sony Michel ranked the highest of the three running backs. I have him at running back 28 right now, and I might be too low on him. That's PPR scoring. I just don't know how much he's going to be used in the passing game. I think he's probably a high, we joke about this phrase, but I do think at the moment, until we get more knowledge out of New England, I feel like he's a high-end flex. If I had to draft today, I think he's a high-end flex because I think that there's tremendous upside, and there's no question he is a skilled player, but also it's a crowded backfield.
Well, I was just going to say what we saw with the Seahawks, we saw with the Patriots last year. I mean, they had injuries across the board at running back. The difference is that they have always maintained the depth to be able to put somebody into position when necessary. So, you know, to me, this just feels like a much in Seattle, it looks more like a panicky move. Like, who are we going to use? And you don't know who's going to rise to the top. In the Patriots, it looks more like they're going to have everybody ready, and they're never going to miss a beat no matter who they plug in where. Rex Burkhead was hurt last year. Mike Gillisley had concussion issues at the start of the season. I mean, and the role that we thought Mike Gillisley would have suddenly became limited, was absent because of his injury.
And by the way, don't forget Jeremy Hill, friend of the podcast, Jeremy Hill. Jeremy Hill obviously has struggled, certainly struggled last year, but there have been times in Jeremy Hill's career where he's been as good around the goal line as anyone in football. He's a guy that, you know, scored a tremendous amount of touchdowns early on. If he can get a fully healthy and shows these guys something in camp and make, there's another guy that they could trust around the goal line. Jeremy Hill doesn't fumble. I mean, that's one thing that has
the
been
Patriots appreciate
the,
that.
The Patriots certainly appreciate. And the one last thing I'll say, Field, and you can speak to this as well, covering the Patriots as you did back in the day, is that, and having worked for the team at one point, that just because I think I've seen a lot of people say, like, well, they used a first-round pick, so they're definitely using him. Like, they're just trying to assemble, I think my sense of the Patriots is that they're just best player available. Like, when their pick came up, that was the guy that they had highest on their draft board. And I mean, look, they traded a first round pick to get Brandon Cooks last year and just as quickly traded him away. And Brandon Cooks' usage last year was certainly inconsistent. So I don't put any stock in Well, they used a first-round pick, so that means automatically he becomes the guy.
It means nothing's going to happen automatically. Certainly gives you a reflection of what they view him as a player. His upside, I do believe, is ridiculous for now.
Of course.
For now, I am still
trying
to get a grip.
Where did you rank him?
I've got him like 40 right now.
Oh, wow. Okay.
But I have Burkhead, where you must have Burkhead closer to 40 and Michelle at 28, you said?
Correct. I have Michelle at 28. I have James White at 31. And I have Burkhead at 46. So that's correct. So you and I are, I just have them flip for now.
This is reality for this entire week ahead. These are all subject to change in a massive, massive way.
Yep.
Let's get to Sony Michel's teammate in college, his backfield teammate, as a matter of fact, Nick Chubb, who goes just four picks later to the Cleveland Browns in what was the third pick of the second round. Chubb and Michel, very different players. Nick Chubb is a bruiser, 5'10", 225 pounds. Stefania, he had a major knee injury a couple of seasons back that temporarily just derailed a college career, but it doesn't seem to be an issue at this point in his NFL playing days.
Right, and I think you always look at what did they come back and do. He played six games that year, it was 2015, came back 13 the next year, 15 games last year. I think the questions have been answered. I think it's worth pointing out that we learned from a research study that was done within the NFL a few years ago. This was the year that Todd Gurley was drafted. This information came out at the scientific presentations they do at the Combine, that a running back who has an ACL reconstruction during their college career is much more likely to suffer another ACL tear, typically within the first 4 years that they enter the NFL. Exhibit A is somebody like Deshaun Watson, you know? And so the risk on these guys coming in, having had a prior ACL injury, is that they are indeed more at risk, but for tearing either the opposite ACL or a re-tear of the same ACL injury that they had. Sometimes there are concerns about degenerative changes in the knee after you have an ACL reconstruction. I think we've seen enough guys come back, and if they prove they can still perform at a high level afterward, depending on what the team needs are, they're willing to take that gamble.
There you go. I'm with you there, and I think that was a very reasonable assessment of team sort of like mindset for injury as it is. It is a crowded backfield in Cleveland all of a sudden. You've got three good players, I think. We all like Nick Chubb as a prospect.
Yep.
If it had been Nick Chubb who went at 31 and not Sony Michel, it wouldn't have stunned me at all.
Right.
Now, different types of players, but I'm just saying from a value standpoint,
Sure. Both
of them merited being a potential first-round pick.
I think what's weird is the Carlos Hyde situation.
Exactly. Right. Now you have Carlos Hyde, who is also in the mix there in Cleveland, got a three-year deal worth $17 million. Of course, in the NFL, as we know, a lot of these contracts are year-to-year propositions.
Correct.
Finally, there's Duke Johnson, who's entering the final year of his contract, but he might be an extension candidate for Cleveland. Three good players. How do you sort of slice and dice this backfield?
Well, I think, so again, with the caveat that as information comes out, as we get closer, as we start seeing how they perform in preseason games, et cetera, they can all change. But at the moment, like, I think it's going to be a committee. And, I mean, look, the problem is that you have nothing to base it on, because everything you know about Cleveland, you have to throw out, because the team is so different this year. It's still what I think an above-average offensive line, even with the retirement of Joe Thomas. You know, they performed well last year when Thomas went down. Obviously, getting Jarvis Landry, a full season of Josh Gordon. We'll see, we'll talk about Corey Coleman or Antonio Callaway, as the number three there. But, another year of David Njoku. So it's an offense that I think is going to look very, very different from last year. And their quarterback play is going to be more competent, whether it's Tyrod Taylor or Baker Mayfield. So we'll talk about that in a second as well.
Sure.
But in terms of this backfield, at the moment, the way I have it ranked, and I could be dead wrong here, but at the moment I have it ranked with, I have Chubb, then Carlos Hyde, then Duke Johnson. And I wonder if that Duke Johnson, who they used as a slot receiver some last year, and Carlos Hyde, who caught 59 balls last year. Carlos Hyde is a much better pass catcher than I think he gets credit for in general NFL circles.
He emerged in that way last year.
Yeah. So could you see Chubb, in effect, being the first or second down back, and Carlos Hyde being a third down back, and Duke Johnson being used in certain passing situations, being used as a receiver, having two back sets where then Duke Johnson, comes out of the backfield and lines up in the slot or something like that, trying to mix and match? One thing I will say is that you think about this division that they're in: Bengals, Steelers, Ravens, three really tough run defenses. It is a, you know, all the cliches, the black and blue division. Like, you need some horses. You need some guys that can really bang there. And, Hugh Jackson, even though it hasn't been this way in Cleveland because their defense has been so bad and they've been out of it, traditionally prior to Cleveland has been a run first coach, has traditionally been a very run heavy coach. So I could certainly see, especially with a mobile quarterback, it being much more of a running back but committee, but could you see Chubb and then Hyde in that order?
Yeah, I suppose so. I think it's just worth noting, if you look around the NFL last year, how many teams would you say, by design, successfully incorporated three running backs on a consistent basis into their offense? I think we can look at what the Eagles did post-Jay Ajayi trade and say them. Ajayi plus LeGarrette Blount plus Corey Clement.
Yep.
I think you can make the case that the Patriots do that probably as well as anybody.
Sure,
that's
of course.
That's their forte, one of their calling cards on offense. Jacksonville, to a degree, did that last year with Leonard Fournette plus Chris Ivory plus
also T.J. Yeldon.
But some of that was when, you know, it was injuries to Fournette. So I agree all three of these players have the talent to be fantasy relevant.
Yeah, I mean,
I don't know if they have the offensive, like, I don't know if they're going to be in enough games where they're leading, which case you can dictate and run your offense as you design, to successfully incorporate all three at the same time.
I mean, there's a couple of teams that jump out that I think will be like that. You know, so you think about, frankly, I think, you know, the Jets last year a little bit with Forte and Powell and Elijah McGuire.
Yep.
I think the Packers will be like this year with Aaron Jones, Jamal Williams,
hope, right?
and Ty Montgomery, all mixing in different ways. I think the Lions are going to be like that. I think you could have argued the Lions last year somewhat. I mean, the Lions couldn't run the ball.
Right. It might have been by design, but it didn't work.
It definitely didn't work, but certainly multiple running backs got touches in their backfield. And I will say Baltimore. I think Buck Allen has carved out a role for himself. I know they're excited to get Kenneth Dixon back and obviously Alex Collins. So there'll be a couple of teams like that. But yeah, to your point, it's going to be tough. I rank them that way. Look, Duke Johnson was a PPR stud last year, so it's a little all over the place. My fear is it's a running back by committee. Again, I have Chubb the highest, but I have Chubb at 32.
Yeah, I have Hyde highest, and then I would go Chubb, and then I would go Duke Johnson. But again, I'm reserving the right to make massive sweeping changes on this one just because there's so much to sort out in that Cleveland backfield.
Yeah.
Let's stay in the second round, and after Nick Chubb was Ronald Jones, the Buccaneers. One of their three or four second round picks. He went to USC, really talented player. They obviously have plenty of talent at the skill positions at USC consistently. I'm not sure right now there is a better opportunity for a rookie running back in terms of the rest of the depth chart than what Ronald Jones has in Tampa Bay. What I mean by that is, listen, I think Saquon Barkley is clearly the best prospect, but they've got Jonathan Stewart and Wayne Gallman, who was okay for them last year, and they still have Paul Perkins. I'm just, you know, naming names here. But Ronald Jones has a massive opportunity right there in Tampa Bay, Matthew.
He does, because, look, there really isn't anyone there, right? So you've got Peyton Barber, obviously Doug Martin, now a member of the Raiders. But Raiders, you know, Jacquizz Rodgers is there. But it is, there's an opportunity there for a running back to come in and really take that job over. Having said that, I think their offensive line is still among the worst in football.
It's poor.
It's a bad offensive line. I don't think they've done enough to address that position in the offseason, or that area on their team in the offseason. Ronald Jones, you know, 6 foot, 200 pounds. Do they view him as a workhorse back? Quotes that I've seen out of Tampa Bay, out of the draft, doesn't seem like. I think Peyton Barber is still going to have a decent amount of work. I don't know that you necessarily want Peyton Barber on your fantasy team, but enough that I think it's going to limit the upside of Ronald Jones. Keep in mind, Winston, you know, is a guy that's always a threat to sort of keep it around the goal line as well. I have Ronald Jones at 26 initially. Is that too low? That could easily be too low. He's a guy that could touch the ball a ton. I'm just nervous that I think you'll see more Peyton Barber than I think people initially expect, and I think it's just such an awful offensive line.
I would just say, little like word of caution on the injury front. So he had a hamstring injury at Combine that prevented him from running as well as he would like. It was suffered during the Combine. And then at his pro day, Ronald Jones ran, and it was better, but it was still not as good as it could be. Now, he was pretty much known for being durable at USC, even as he absorbed more of the workload. He stayed you know, he managed to stay healthy. But we have seen some running backs who come in, and here's just something to keep in mind. A lot of these guys train for the combine.
Yep.
The training they go through for the combine puts them in all this speed work, et cetera, and you see these hamstring injuries come out. And then they work on trying to get it better, but when they get to camp and they start shifting into football,
right,
they struggle, and sometimes they aggravate the hamstring injury. Just look at a couple of the rookies in the past. David Johnson, who ended up missing a lot of his rookie season because of a hamstring injury that was really set off during the early part of camp.
Mm.
You look at like Joey Ross,
sure,
who ended up with a hamstring injury that compromised him going forward. So
John Ross, you mean?
John Ross. I went to college with a Joey Ross, so that must have been on my mind.
Shout out to him.
Yeah, shout out to him. But
I went to college with Rick Ross. Shout out to Rick.
There you go.
But you look at some of these.
When I was in college, I watched Ross on Friends. All right, there we go.
Okay, but you look at some of these like freshmen, you know, as they're coming in and transitioning from a way of training for the combine to getting back into football. And think about how long it's been since they played football. They start doing different kind of drills, different kinds of running work, and they struggle, especially if they've come in with a hamstring injury. It can be a problem, and that can affect their position on the depth chart.
So I just, you know, again, I agree with what Stefania said right there. And I think it actually, Matthew's point about Peyton Barber too is, you know, I think Ronald Jones, if I had to sort of assess the top five or six guys amongst the running back class, Ronald Jones was the least workhorsey in my book.
Right.
That makes sense.
Yeah.
Maybe Sony Michel as well, in part because Sony Michel played such a running back by committee offense at Georgia. But I think there's a chance that, the best opportunity presents itself to Ronald Jones, but maybe he still has a somewhat limited. I say limited; it's some of a generic term, but not as much. Like, I don't know that 300 touches are coming his way next year.
Right. Now, listen. I mean, Winston has used the running back in terms of his offense before. I could see him being a PPR star, but right now, I think he's more of a. Until we get a little bit more clarity on Tampa Bay, and we see if that offense can rebound and if they can effectively run the ball, because they couldn't last year. And how much of that was on Doug Martin and how much of that was on the struggles of the offense, I don't know. But they were not good last year.
They were not. Let's keep it moving with other running backs that were taken in the second round. I'm not sure there's a team that had a more desperate need to infuse its backfield with young talent than the Detroit Lions, who dip into the Auburn well. Auburn has almost always had very successful college running backs, many who have gone on to play in the pros. Kerryon Johnson goes 43rd overall. Kerryon Johnson was the SEC Offensive Player of the Year in 2017.
Yeah.
The SEC, as we know, the predominant conference, or the most dominant conference in college football. Matthew, I know LeGarrette Blount is there for 1 year. But how excited are you about Kerryon Johnson as a factor, maybe not just for 2018, but potentially for the long haul in Detroit?
I think that's a great point, because I think he's a better pick for Dynasty than he is necessarily for this year. I think he's more of a running back three this year.
Yep.
Because you're still going to have Theo Riddick involved in the passing game. And there's a potential that, remember, LeGarrette Blount is coming there. And even though it's a one-year deal for LeGarrette Blount, their new head coach, Matt Patricia, obviously the general manager, Bob Quinn, both former New England Patriot employees,
yep,
who obviously both were there during LeGarrette Blount's heyday. My expectation is that at least initially, Blount's going to get the goal line work.
Oh, yeah. He's the starter.
Kerryon Johnson, I think, is an interesting guy. Certainly a lot of talent. I will tell you that the Detroit, from what I understand reading, that the Redskins were about to take him at 44.
Right.
They were planning on taking Kerryon Johnson at 44. The Lions traded into the pick at 43 and snag him, which is when the Redskins then decided to trade with San Francisco and traded back. Still got my boy Darius Guice,
baby. Talking about him next,
we'll talk about him in a second. But the fact of the matter is that there are a lot of teams that really liked Kerryon Johnson. For this year, for redraft leagues, I think he's much more interesting as a dynasty prospect, because I just don't see him, you know, he's part of a running back by committee on a team that has yet to prove they can run the ball effectively. It has been a struggle for Detroit for a long time.
Super determined to run the football this year in Detroit. And the good news is, although it's a new head coach and a new defensive staff, it's largely the same offensive staff. Obviously, our boy Jim Bob Cooter continues to coordinate
our
that
future
offense.
President.
Listen, you know they want to run the football. I mean, it's not like they didn't want to run. It's just a matter of. They didn't have the infrastructure.
So we'll see if they do. And obviously the signing of Blount, the drafting of Johnson are attempts to address that. It will be interesting to see, Field, if when the season starts, Amir Abdullah is on this team.
I agree with you, Matthew. I would imagine that right now is a good time for teams to start looking at depth charts around the NFL and say, all right, we didn't quite fill in our needs here. Let's see if someone else might become available there, and we could trade for that player or wait it out and see if he gets released at some point between now and the start of the season. All right, for the most important part of the show, we turn to the back end of the second round, pick number 59 overall.
Did you work on this nickname?
Hail to the Redskins.
All week in preparation.
What, Geist Baby? Yeah. That's not mine. I mean, lots of people were saying that. I don't even know if that's his nickname. I don't care. I'm thrilled. Listen, are there maturity issues? I don't know. Whatever. I'm immature.
With you?
Yeah, exactly. Right. I mean, whatever. Look, I don't know what the off the field issues were. One of the rumors was about an altercation with his visit to the Philadelphia Eagles, of which the Eagles came out and said definitively that did not happen. There are lots of sort of rumors out there about off the field issues. I can't speak to any of them. I can merely say that as a Redskins fan and seeing what I have seen on film of Darius Geis, I could not be more thrilled. This is a guy that on pure talent alone projected as a mid-first rounder. A lot of people thought maybe the Redskins would take him at 13, which was their first round pick. So to get him at 59, I think is absolutely amazing. If you look at my column from Out of the Combine just talk around the Redskins, they were not happy with what they got out of Rob Kelly and Samaje Perine on first and second down last year. They're thrilled with Chris Thompson, obviously. He got hurt towards the end of the year. Darius Geis is going to get the ball a lot. When you talk about opportunity here, I mean, here's a guy that could easily touch the ball again 20 times. The last 3 years, Alex Smith was the quarterback in Kansas City. They ranked fourth in total rushing yards. Alex Smith, a much more mobile quarterback than he gets credit for. And so Geis, who is just such a physical beast, 5'11", 212 pounds, averaged over 6 yards a carry in his three years at LSU.
Right.
Again, playing in the SEC, very tough defenses that he faced. He faced stacked boxes so many times at LSU. So I'm all in on Darius Geis, and the Redskins offensive line, now fully healthy, should be excellent again. I think Bill Callahan, one of the best offensive line coaches in football. So I'm very excited about Geis. You bring him down a little bit in PPR because I expect him to come off the field on third down. But I have him at 19, and I might be too low.
Ooh, interesting. Certainly he has the upside there just because of the role available and the player talent. They don't have a starting running back on that roster. And before people scream at me and say, what about Chris Thompson? Chris Thompson is a terrific. He's one of the best satellite backs in the league.
Correct.
But there's a reason why he's not carried the football 25 times in a game consistently. Great complimentary piece to Darius Geis.
Last year when he was exploding and having these huge plays and he was, becoming a kind of a fantasy darling, and people kept asking Jay Gruden, why aren't you playing him more? And the thing is, we want to limit his touches because we don't want this kid to get hurt. And as the season went on and more players went down and he started touching the ball more, what ends up happening? Chris Thompson ended up getting hurt, which has happened to him multiple times throughout his career, Stefania, in college and in the pros.
Yeah, and I would say, he's a guy that I'm going to be watching to see what he's doing. He just started doing some stuff on the field late at the end of March. So he's not out of the woods as far as recovering from this injury.
Yeah, I wouldn't be surprised if one of, Samaje Perine and Rob Kelly is looking for work.
I think one of those guys makes the team, and one of them is looking for work. I do know they also like Byron Marshall, who filled in for Thompson towards the end of the year as a pass catcher. But to your point, in terms of what we were talking about with Ronald Jones, opportunity is there for a huge workload on a pretty good offense. This is not me being a Redskin homer. Say what you want about Jay Gruden and the Redskins, but they have, since Jay Gruden has come to the Redskins, they've consistently put up points. It has never been an issue about the offense in Washington under Jay Gruden.
I agree on that part. Let's go to the third round, where running backs continue to be a theme. Let's go to Denver specifically, as Royce Freeman, who went to Oregon, where they have produced plenty of NFL draft prospects at the running back spot, lands in Denver, where the depth chart is somewhat barren right now. It is Devontae Booker.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That's it.
That's really, that's of no.
Barren.
Yeah, exactly.
It's like my head.
Yeah. It is kind of like your head.
It's a little bit. Yeah,
it's
exactly.
A great analogy.
Yeah.
So Devontae Booker and Royce Freeman, for those who don't know about Freeman, I mean, literally record-setting production at Oregon. Again, they've produced a lot of running backs. Not all of them have become
Jonathan Stewart.
Good players in the NFL, but Jonathan Stewart, LaMichael James, there have been a lot of guys. Like Garrett Blunt obviously went there. There have been plenty of running backs to come through Oregon. None have matched the production of Royce Freeman. Matthew's 5'11", 231 pounds. I am not a Devontae Booker fan. I think he's just average.
Right.
I wouldn't be surprised if Royce Freeman's our new starting running back.
I think he absolutely is. You know, hearing quotes about from John Elway about the selection of Royce Freeman, and I'm paraphrasing here. I don't have the exact quote in front of me, but he was using words like he's a thumper. He's a true bell cow kind of running back. He's a guy that can get it going for us on first and second down, a guy that can carry the load in a big way. I mean, I think to your point, Field, I think Freeman has as much, I mean, it was really interesting. You know, we talk about Ronald Jones, we talk about Darius Geisel, we talk about Saquon Barkley in terms of running backs that land at positions where there's just a wide open playing field. Fantasy value, obviously, is not just about talent, but also opportunity. And it feels like more than most years in recent history, there are a number of talented running backs landing in opportunities, landing in spots where there's a lot of opportunity to touch the ball. And Denver is another one of those spots. Royce Freeman, for me, is number 22. Here, and I could certainly see him moving up as we get closer to August. So I have as a very high end flex or borderline RB2. Want to see how much he's going to be used in the passing game. But look, Broncos top 8 in rush attempts last year. I mean, like, and he's a big back that I think their offense obviously improves under Case Keenum. So yeah, Royce Freeman lands in just about as good a spot as you could ask for if you're a running back.
Again, I could be wrong here, but I wouldn't be surprised if the Broncos are in the market for one more veteran running back. Even after cutting CJ Anderson, you might say, well, maybe they're trying to go young, but look at the depth chart. It still could use maybe one or two more pieces to round it out.
Because I mean, Henderson and Booker are both pretty young players, and so you wouldn't mind one more veteran guy.
Matthew, how about one or two names amongst running backs that were drafted on day 3 or beyond, it might strike you as, hey, based off where they landed, this could be a pretty ideal fantasy spot.
You know, just, I don't know that you're even drafting any of these guys, but, you know, maybe somebody to think about in Dynasty or if you're in deeper leagues. Kalen Ballage, who went to the Dolphins in round 4, 6'3", 230 pounds. Field. You want to talk about a thumper. I mean, so here's a guy that could easily get there. And then you look at this depth chart, right? It's Frank Gore. Who knows how much he has left in the tank? I mean, anytime you doubt Frank Gore, you get proven wrong. But Kenyon Drake has just 5 career games with 10 or more carries. How much do they want Kenyon Drake to carry the mail? Here's a guy that I could easily see being a touchdown vulture.
Yep. I love myself some Nyheim Hines. That was the one that I'm keeping an eye on. The 104th pick overall out of NC State.
I've got one.
Yeah.
Jordan Mailata. Is that how you pronounce it? The rugby player
who the Eagles took
mostly just because I could not stop watching the video of him trucking over
tackle.
They're gonna put him on the offensive line, but
they should put him at running back.
I think they should put him at running back. I know he's never played before, but why not just give him the ball and see what he can do?
He knows what he's doing based off his rugby.
those have been fun to watch. There's no question about that. But back to Hines for a second. Along with Jordan Wilkins, those two guys were drafted by the Colts. It seems like going into the draft field, I thought that the Colts would add somebody. And maybe they add C.J. Anderson or DeMarco Murray. The sense that I got from Chris Ballard at the Combine was that they didn't believe in Marlon Mack as a true three-down bell cow running back. But as it stands now, he's their starter. But certainly, Hines is an interesting guy, 5'9", 197 pounds. Hines, you could certainly see getting some early down work and mixing in with Marlon Mack there.
Good opportunity there at the moment. We're going to take a quick break. And when we come back, we're going to talk wide receivers, quarterbacks, and maybe a little bit of tight end flair as well.
I don't know how else to say this, so I'll just say it.
What is it, Linda?
I think we should see other people.
Are you breaking up with me on a roller coaster?
Well, we do have a lot of fun. Maybe we should stay together.
An emotional roller coaster? Surprising. What's not surprising? How much you could save by switching to Geico.
I just need a little me time.
Geico. 15 minutes could save you 15% or more.
We're back now, and of course, it's time to talk wide receivers. Two of them went in the first round, the very first wide receiver taken. With DJ Moore from Maryland, he goes to the Carolina Panthers. Matthew, I think that I think we have a sort of an idea of how this receiver class was regarded, given none of them went until 24th overall.
Right.
So this is not a Mike Evans or a even Sammy Watkins type pedigree of player.
No.
But based off of the offense he's playing in, they need a wide receiver depth in a bad way in Carolina.
Yeah, they did. But in terms of for our perspective, I mean, I can't imagine drafting a rookie wide receiver this year in a redraft league except as a late, late round flyer. You think about last year.
We have, right? Most of what you know right now, I agree.
Yeah, I mean, so, right. I mean, so DJ Moore is certainly an impressive player. You know, Steve Smith, friend of the podcast, Steve Smith, I remember saying, like, Carolina's been looking to replace me. They finally did.
Yep.
With DJ Moore, high praise indeed. You know, Mike Clay projects him at 40 receptions, 544 yards, 3 touchdowns. That sounds right to me because you think about the pass catchers in Carolina. Yes, they have some need at wide receiver. We're waiting to see what happens with Curtis Samuel and can he come back healthy. But, you know, but beside Devin Funchess, you've got Greg Olsen. You've got Christian McCaffrey. So while they don't have a ton of wide receiver depth, they certainly have a number of talented pass catchers. Don't forget Torrey Smith, also a member of the Carolina Panthers. They'll take some deep shots at to him as well. So DJ Moore, more interesting from a dynasty perspective than he is from redraft. I don't see him having a significantly big role this year.
Agree, and I think that one of the players I would have been more interested in if he had landed higher up in the draft would have been Calvin Ridley. But
yeah,
he slid, and he slid, and he slid some more to 26, where the Atlanta Falcons take Calvin Ridley to join Julio Jones and Mohamed Sanu. Not bad if your number three wide receiver is arguably the best rookie wideout in this year's class.
You know, and certainly you talk about just a great landing spot if you're Calvin Ridley, right? So, Steve Sarkisian, who is the offense coordinator of the Atlanta Falcons, was the offense coordinator of Alabama in 2016.
Yep.
So he is very familiar with Calvin Ridley. There's a familiarity there. Thomas Dimitrioff talking about how Sark really went to bat for Calvin Ridley about what a great kid he is and how much he could add to this offense. So I think it's a great landing spot for Ridley, and I think it helps Matt Ryan, another really talented guy. But then you think about where the touchdown's coming for Calvin Ridley. You know, because we expect Julio Jones to get more touchdowns this year, you know, to regress a little bit more to the mean. Sanu had a fantastic year last year. So I just don't see a ton of touchdowns for Ridley. Again, love Ridley in Dynasty. Really talented player. But I just don't see him scoring a ton in this offense. Mike's projections have him at 48 receptions, 608 yards, 3.5 touchdowns. Like, that sounds about right to me. I mean, you know, like, I don't think I even ranked Ridley in redraft. If I did, it was like in the, you know, it was like in the 55, somewhere in the 55 to 65 range. Like,
yeah, it's going to be hard to find too many rookie wide receivers that crack our top 60. And going into the summit, we did rank 60 players at both running back and wideout. But Cortland Sutton might actually have a case. Maybe more so for 2019, but he goes to the Broncos, 40th overall. He went to SMU, 6'4", 215 pounds.
Yeah.
It's a massive, massive wideout. There was some speculation, at least a question mark, as to whether the Broncos would exercise both Emmanuel Sanders and Demaryius Thomas's options.
Correct.
This offseason. So maybe this is a let's look ahead to 2019 pick, but Sutton's kind of intriguing. Like Maybe the play is this, late round flyer for him in redraft leagues, but in Dynasty, you know, maybe not just because he was a third wide receiver drafted, but based off opportunity, he might not have a choice but to be your third wide receiver in Dynasty leagues.
Yeah, I mean, we don't, I think, you know, with both Demaryius Thomas and Emmanuel Sanders in their 30s, and there's no question, there were offseason questions about would both guys be back with the Broncos. I think this is a pick for the future.
Yeah.
Not necessarily a pick for right now. I mean, I think he'll be their number three wide receiver. They have Carlos Henderson there as well. So, you know, they've drafted a couple of young guys.
Yep.
As well. But to your point, Sutton over 1,000 yards, at least 10 touchdowns in each of the last two seasons when he was in college. And, you know, the problem is that since Emmanuel Sanders came over in 2014, Denver's third option in terms of receiving yards has averaged just 405 receiving yards. There just has. We just talked about Freeman. We expect a lot from Freeman, and you know, we expect Case Keenum to be better than the quarterback play they've had in recent years. But still, it's as long as Thomas and Sanders are healthy, doesn't leave a lot for a guy like Sutton.
The 49ers moved up in the second round to snag Dante Pettis, pick 44 overall. Stefania, I think the reality is though, the value for him might not just be as a wide receiver, but we're talking about an historic career returning kicks at Washington. He must be exciting for you guys in the special teams game.
Right, and they're so good. I think what I'm seeing now from this front office is that they're pretty good at finding versatility in their players and using them in slightly different ways. So I agree. Like, I think Marquise Goodwin is going to be the clear number one in San Francisco in terms of receiving options. Obviously, you're going to get
Pierre Garçon. I was going to say Pierre Garçon.
I know that he's there. I think Marquise Goodwin is going to
look at Stefania throwing
you will,
down.
You will see that in my rank reflected in my rankings.
Wow. I think Pierre Garçon. I'm not ready to go there just yet. I do like Goodwin.
You don't have to go there. My point is that they will use different options, and they're changing up the way that they use guys. So using this guy on special teams and having him as an option wide receiver is certainly a possibility.
But to your point, whether it's Garçon, whether it's Goodwin, whether it's George Kittle, who came on towards the end of last year, or whether it's Jerick McKinnon out of the backfield, they have a lot of, they suddenly have a lot of people that can catch the ball in San Francisco, and we're expecting big things from Jimmy Garoppolo, well, Jimmy GQ,
and let's
your boyfriend.
Not forget where he studied. You know, and a team where you used all your options, right? You know, he was at the Patriots, and we know how many different pass catchers they have, whether they fall under the category of running back or wide receiver.
Nice move for the 49ers, not necessarily fantasy relevant this year.
I think one that could be fantasy relevant in the second round is Christian Kirk. He goes 47th overall to the Arizona Cardinals. Went to Texas A&M.
Gig him.
Thank you. Really, really solid career there.
And I love Christian Kirk. I mean, listen, I'm an Aggie fan. I grew up in College Station, obviously. So I love Christian Kirk, but I actually am.
What?
I'm low on him for this year in redraft.
Here's the reason why I'm not. So number two wide receiver in Arizona is presumably an open competition, right? We know it's Fitz number one. Is the mitigating factor for Kirk that you don't trust the quarterback play? You don't think it's going to be the number two wide receiver? Or what is it that you are, makes you think he
it's both
might,
those. I mean, he was primarily a slot receiver in college. Mm. So Kent, I mean, and at the moment, they have a pretty good slot receiver. I just don't see Larry Fitzgerald sitting down for Christian Kirk this year. So the question is what is the learning curve? Does Arizona say, like, look, a lot of people use the draft about, it's not about this year, it's about next year. Occasionally teams will use it to fill needs for this year, but for Arizona, which is sort of kind of in a rebuilding process, obviously Josh Rosen, their first round pick. I mean, they know, you know, new head coach, like they're starting to rebuild. So how much of Christian Kirk is like, hey, just come here, learn from one of the greatest to ever play the game. Mm-hmm. And, you know, Larry's going to retire at the end of this year, and then you're our guy, and you'll develop a chemistry with Rosen. Or how much of it is like, hey, let's put you outside. Let's see how much you can do on the outside. So that's my concern with Christian Kirk. So he's at best, he would be the third option behind Larry Fitzgerald and David Johnson in terms of pass catchers, in my belief. Especially because whether it's Bradford or Josh Rosen, I think you'll see a lot of dump offs. Mike McCoy's offense tend to feature that. And by the way, I'm a Bryce Butler believer. I'm like free Bryce Butler. So, I mean, Bryce Butler now going to Arizona, obviously getting a chance to potentially be the number two, right? Freed from the shadow of Dez Bryant. Like whether it's him or JJ Nelson, does Chad Williams take a step up? I don't know. My concern is I don't see Christian Kirk getting significant playing time. I could be wrong, but that's why.
Interesting. I have a little bit more optimism. He'll cement a role earlier on in his NFL career. Another number two wide receiver.
He's another guy though, by the way, that could also, he's a great special teams player.
Terrific.
He's a great returner. So, which is important for NFL, doesn't help necessarily in all fantasy leagues, depends on what your scoring is. But again, those are snaps that are taken away from
his offensive role. Anthony Miller from the Bears, they actually traded back up into the second round to grab him. He went to Memphis. Crazy production. 31 touchdown catches over the past 2 years. Matthew, you already have Allen Robinson. You have Trey Burton. You signed Taylor Gabriel. I say Kevin White, but at this point, it's really
who knows.
Yeah,
could he get in there? I mean, this is one of the more interesting rookies because of the potential opportunity. You've still got a second year quarterback, and in addition to all the guys you've mentioned, don't forget Tariq Cohen, who Matt Nagy has said he wants to use more, and you know, similar to what he was doing with Tyreek Hill. Right. They're different players, different positions, but you'll see Tariq Cohen involved much more in the passing game this year than I think even he was last year.
I just was surprised. Like, I think that, and again, not to overthink things in the draft or try to make them simple, because they are often not that. They're often imperfect. But when you trade back up into the second round, and by the way, you traded the Patriots a second round pick next year, which I think there's a pretty good chance the Bears will be one of the 20 worst teams in football next year, which would mean the pick
100%
would be higher than 51 next year. You must have some conviction about this player. So Anthony Miller is a name for now. Keep him on your radar.
He's a talented kid, and it would not surprise me to see him carve out a role. He's definitely somebody that worth a late round flyer.
Just more speed dating type with these wide receivers that were taken at pick 60 or beyond. DJ Chark went to LSU, ran, I believe, the fastest 40 time amongst all wideouts at the combine. Obviously can scoot. Matthew, in Jacksonville, though, the issue might be they don't have a clear cut dominant number one wide receiver, but all of a sudden they got a bunch of guys that are pretty steady. You got Marquise Lee back. You've got
D.D. Westbrook.
I was going to say Dante Moncrief, who was signed this past year.
Right.
You've got D.D. Westbrook. You've got Kalen Clay. You got all these guys that are pretty solid players. So where exactly does Kalen Cole? Where exactly does DJ Chark fit into this rotation?
I don't know, but I'm very excited to see the first headline writer to come up with "Jump the Shark." Jags jump the shark.
Jags jump the shark. Well done.
When he like catches some touchdown to win a game. And by the way, not only do they have a lot of guys there, but don't forget Austin Seferian Jenkins.
Yep.
They signed him at tight end. And it's a run first offense. It's still going to be a run first offense. Even though Bortles played better down the stretch, Doug Marrone wants to run the ball and win with his defense, which is the best in the NFL. So, I can't imagine. Mike Clay's projections are 320 yards and under two touchdowns.
All right,
He would be, even in Dynasty, because there's a lot of young guys there in Jacksonville as well.
Yep.
He's somebody I'm not as interested in. The next guy on our list, however, I do think is pretty interesting, and I think he could end up being the number one rookie wide receiver this year.
That's Michael Gallup from Colorado State. He goes 81st overall to the Dallas Cowboys. It's the third round. Again, remember this, after cutting Dez Bryant, that depth chart at wide receiver is not particularly noteworthy in Dallas. Yep. Terrence Williams is also battling a foot issue this offseason. They did draft Michael Gallup, and they did trade for Tavon Austin.
Right. But word I'm hearing out of Dallas is that they want to use Tavon Austin similar to how they used Lance Dunbar back in the day. So
more as a running back,
as a pass-catching running back, and less as a wide receiver. You think about Gallup, 6'1", 200 pounds, kind of a bigger-bodied guy. Who knows what you're going to get out of Allen Hurns. And by the way, as long as we're just sort of talking about the Cowboys, we haven't gotten to tight ends yet, but there is a chance, our own Chris Mortensen reporting, that Jason Witten has received an offer to join us here at ESPN, color commentary on Monday Night Football. There's apparently another network offer, interested as well. So there's a chance that Dak Prescott goes into this year with his two top pass catchers from last year unavailable, and so you're looking around, and so you do have Hurns there, but Mike Gallup, who had 21 touchdowns in two seasons at Colorado State, could suddenly be interesting. I'm not predicting big things for him, but I did rank him, which is something I can't say for a lot of rookie wide receivers this year.
The opportunity is certainly there. It's just a matter of time before Dallas drafted a wide receiver. They also drafted a tight end, by the way, as potential Jason Witten insurance. No final word on Jason Witten. The expectation is we'll know for sure by Wednesday. So if you're listening to this on Wednesday, you may be saying, I already know that Jason Witten is either committed back to the Cowboys or heading to the next phase of his professional career.
And just as long as we brought up Witten just very quickly, I do think Rico Gathers is kind of interesting in a tight end too sort of way.
Mm.
Former basketball player, didn't get a lot of work because Jason Witten's an Iron Man.
Yep.
But I do know that they like him there in Dallas.
Our trade happened, it took place in the second round, but it was for a third round pick. Martavis Bryant goes from the Pittsburgh Steelers to the Oakland Raiders. Pick 79 was the compensation. He's got 1 year left on his contract, and he gets his wish. He has wanted to be traded for quite some time now. Obviously, he fits into Oakland alongside Amari Cooper and also Jordan Nelson. If you look at those three pass catchers, sort of as a whole, Matthew, as a composite, where does Martavis Bryant sort of slot amongst those three? Is he the number two?
I think he's the number
two. Number two, based on ability, I think you can make that case pretty easily, right?
I think he's the number two. I could easily be proven wrong, and we'll see when they get about there. I think Jordy Nelson's done. It's unfortunate because
not
I love
him. He's not going to make the roster. But
no,
like
I just,
Dunn isn't
I just
like
think
his
in Dunn,
days of being a dominant player over.
Correct. I think he is, you know, his day. It'll be interesting to see. This is the debate. Who moves to the slot? You're obviously going to have Martavis Bryant out in the split. And so conventional wisdom, is it Jordy Nelson, right? Because he has lost his step and maybe, you know, he certainly still has sure hands. You know, could you see him in the slot? But it's sort of interesting. What if they moved Amari Cooper to the slot? Remember that Kansas City game last year in week 7 when he just went off and went crazy? 11 targets, 6 for 95, and a touch. Yeah, we talked about that. Field traded him that morning, and then that night, Amari Cooper went off for like 200 yards or whatever it was. Just an insane game. 44 fantasy points. Just crazy, crazy. But 6 for 95 and a touchdown and 11 targets out of the slot in that game. They moved Cooper to the slot in that particular game, and some of that was based on the matchup and how much the Chiefs had struggled there. But the fact of the matter is Amari Cooper in the slot has been – it's limited, but has been very effective. I wonder, could they see if they, I don't see him that way, but they could still see Jordy, having his best role out wide. So it'll be interesting to see. I rank them though, Cooper, Bryant, and then Jordy Nelson. Remember, over the last 3 seasons, only Russell Wilson has thrown more deep touchdown passes than Derek Carr. He likes to chuck it deep. And Martavis Bryant, maybe a new situation, new atmosphere, new leash on life, whatever you want to, what new lease on life, whatever, yep. I should say, whatever cliche you want to use. It's, we know the talent is there.
It's a very interesting situation. As a matter of fact, the Raiders, they may not be very good this year, but I am extremely interested to see how this roster shakes out because there's a lot of moving parts, a lot that I don't necessarily understand from this offseason, but they will be compelling all the same.
He's right there in the 40s for me at wide receiver. Like I'm at 43. I think there's some tremendous upside with Martavis Bryant.
Let's get to the quarterbacks. This is
and very quickly, I should just say, the Steelers drafted the Martavis Bryant, replacement, James Washington, who can just absolutely fly.
Yeah. I remember tweeting at the time that whenever the Steelers take a wide receiver in the second round, I just immediately assume he's going to be really good because their track record in the second round is pretty sweet amongst wide receivers. Let's go to the quarterbacks, just to put a bow on this quarterbacks.
It's early in the season. I might as well interrupt you. One last thing real quickly. Antonio Callaway of the Cleveland Browns, really talented player. If it wasn't for off-the-field issues, probably would have gone in the first round. He's got that kind of talent. There are multiple off-the-field concerns with Callaway. Certainly you talk about opportunity. Is it Corey Coleman? Or you could see Callaway, if he gets his head on straight, things work out for him in Cleveland. He's got the kind of talent to be on the field and be a part of that offense.
He most recently made headlines for having the diluted sample at the combine, which NFL teams truly frown upon that because
that's
just poor decision making beyond anything else. All right, for the quarterbacks, there were 4 of them taken in the top 10 for the first time ever. 5 go in the first round as Lamar Jackson was a 32nd overall pick. You know the names already. Baker Mayfield's a Brown. Sam Darnold is a Jet. Josh Allen is a Bill. Josh Rosen a Cardinal. Lamar Jackson, as we just said, a Baltimore Raven. Do any of these quarterbacks strike you as likeliest to play in this season? Because I think the answer is we know that teams rarely redshirt quarterbacks, but I could see a scenario where none of them start on day one.
I would agree with that. I could definitely see a scenario where none of them start on day one. I cannot see a scenario where none of them play this year. I actually think with the possible exception of Lamar Jackson, depending on how the Ravens season goes.
Right.
I could see all of them becoming the starting quarterback of their team at some point this year. In fact, that's what I would expect.
Mm-hmm. Yep. No, I believe that as well. And Matthew, I just don't know that, like, because I can't assess any of them as likely to be a starter in week one, how could I possibly thrust any of them into the top 30 for quarterbacks? Tyrod Taylor ranked. I think Josh McCown snuck in the 20s because he was good last year, by the way, for the Jets.
Well, let's do this then. How about this?
Yep.
For dynasty purposes, why don't we rank them? And then also, let's play a game. If all of them were if we got the alert, Adam Schefter just tweets, every single one of these quarterbacks is starting week one.
Yep.
How would you rank them? So we'll start for dynasty purposes because that's more relevant, I think. Who's your number one quarterback dynasty-wise?
So the question
this is
not
dynasty.
About Schefter's.
No. We'll do that in a second.
Dynasty.
Dynasty-wise.
Number one, Baker Mayfield.
I think it might be Lamar Jackson for me, but I don't
have number one to the next question, but number one for dynasty is Baker Mayfield for me. Only because, I think that he has the most avenues to fantasy success.
Yep.
To say about that is he is not nearly the athlete as Lamar Jackson, but he does have creativity with his scrambling skills, and he's a much more refined passer at this juncture of their respective careers. Josh Rosen, Josh Allen, Sam Darnold, all going to operate at best from the pockets. Number one would be Mayfield. Number two would be Jackson. Number three will be Darnold. Number four will be Rosen. Number five will be Allen. Allen has, and this is just like, it's a cliche, but sometimes cliches exist for a reason is what they say, and he has the highest ceiling and the lowest floor of all these guys.
I completely agree. You and I have one and two swapped. I would have Jackson one, Mayfield two, but I would agree with your order, Darnold, Rosen, Allen in that order. Yep. I mean, just the Bills, I'm not convinced Josh Allen is an NFL quarterback. I mean, in terms of like, we'll see, I don't know that he's a franchise guy. I could be dead wrong, obviously, but there's a lot of red flag, right?
Sure,
I get it. 6'5" and a cannon for an arm and everything like that. But it's also a depleted roster.
Right,
it's a tough situation.
The thing is that sometimes the dynasty equation changes with, you know, one swipe of an off season, because last year at this time, Mitchell Trubisky's best wide receiver going into the season was, I guess, Cameron Meredith before he got hurt.
Right.
Now it's Allen Robinson and Trey Burton and, you know, we
Taylor, like, Gabriel, Taylor Gabriel and right,
and,
you know,
and we just talked about Anthony Miller.
Yep.
So things can change quite a bit. But in terms of pure player abilities, Baker Mayfield would be number one for me. But if the question were if Schefter swiped them all or, you know, gave us the notification that all of them were starting right away, it'd be Lamar Jackson. Now, Lamar Jackson, trust me, I understand why he has been a galvanizing player during the pre-draft process. Draft Twitter liked him a lot more than quote-unquote NFL scouts and evaluators liked him. That was backed up by the fact that he went 32nd overall. Like, we thought he was out of the first round. And he goes 32nd to the Baltimore Ravens, who traded back up to get him with their second first-round pick. So it's clear that many in the NFL are not sold on him. And the obvious limitation for Lamar Jackson is he's not a great thrower right now. He just isn't. And I'm not saying that any of these guys is a perfect thrower, but Josh Allen and Lamar Jackson present huge question marks as throwers right now.
Right.
Huge.
Yeah, I mean,
but Lamar Jackson's the best athlete at quarterback that we've seen. And
he will run like crazy.
Better than Michael Vick.
And we think about the kind of the fantasy success that Michael Vick has had, you know, in his years. And a lot of the people that were there with Michael Vick in Atlanta are now in Baltimore. And so, they're going to work on him. I mean, this is a project. Joe Flacco has struggled. It would not surprise me, Field Yates, if Joe Flacco was on another team in 2019.
That certainly seems to be very possible, which we would not have thought a week ago at this time.
Yeah.
You know?
I will say, to your point about Baker Mayfield, I mean, Baker Mayfield, who had 11 rushing touchdowns in 2 years, at Oklahoma, you know, kind of an interesting guy. And then you think about Josh Gordon, Jarvis Landry, like, you know, like, I mean, they've got a lot of young, talented players there in Cleveland all of a sudden for Baker Mayfield to build around. I would agree with you there.
All right, let's just do a little wrap up here with the tight ends. We mentioned the news about Jason Witten. That was sort of the most prominent tight end news from the weekend. But specific to the draft, Hayden Hurst was the only first round pick amongst tight ends this year. 25-year-old who was picked 25 in this year's class. He's 6'5", 250 pounds. He actually played minor league baseball for a few years, which is why he's 25 going into his rookie season in the NFL. He goes to the Ravens. The Ravens are clearly overhauling their offense this draft and this offseason. Matthew, you convinced that we know it's very rare for rookie tight ends to make an immediate impact. Are you convinced that any of these guys will do so in 2018?
I'm not. I mean, if I had to pick a Ravens tight end, I don't think I'd even go with Hayden Hurst. I think it's Mark Andrews, who I think Hayden Hurst is going to be more of the traditional blocking tight end. Andrews, a better pass catcher.
Andrews went to Oklahoma. He actually started as a wide receiver. He was like absolutely steadfast going into college that I am going to go somewhere and play wide receiver. Well, he starts at wide receiver at Oklahoma, and they're like, you know something, you're going to switch tight end. He goes, okay, fine. So he relented after just one season, I believe it was. An excellent, excellent athlete. I'm not sure he could block you or I at this stage of his career, but that will develop.
6'5", 254 pounds. To your point, if I had to pick a tight end, but, I mean, rookie tight end success is fleeting in the NFL. And for everyone, you know, Evan Ingram, I hear you. I feel like Evan Ingram, as great a player as he was, that was a fluke situation last year. He's a complete outlier, especially when you think about Beckham, Shepard, Marshall, all getting hurt last year when he was basically the last guy standing that anyone could catch a pass. I mean, so
it's not quite as egregious as when we compare six-footer under quarterbacks to Drew Brees, but rookie tight ends being compared to Evan Ingram, like, come on, Mike. Exceptions, not rules here.
Correct. But if I had to pick one, how about Mike Gesicki of the Dolphins, 6'6", 250 pounds. He can't teach that, Stefania. You know that. Better than anyone. You just you can't teach 6 foot
pride,
six.
Obviously. Yep.
Yeah, absolutely. Nice pass catcher and going to an Adam Gase offense, which has, you know, hasn't really worked out so far in Miami yet. Yep. A lot hasn't really worked out yet in Miami, but at previous stops as an offense coordinator, he's always used his tight end. And so I think he's continually been looking for, you know, that pass catching tight end. So if I had to pick somebody, give me Gesicki. But again, I don't know that I'm drafting a rookie tight end this year.
The comp is Julius Thomas in Denver. Like, that's, I mean, he's a better athlete than Julius Thomas, but that's the idea. A guy who could win with his athletic ability. He can outjump you. He can outrun you. He can do things with the football after the catch. He cannot block worth a lick right now. Yeah. But for fantasy football, we don't keep track of blocking points, which is good news. So I'm with you. It's a second-round pick for Miami.
Nine touchdowns last year for Penn State.
Really good player. He dominated in the bowl game.
Yeah.
Awesome in the pre-draft process in a lot of ways. You know, the biggest problem is I don't trust the quarterback.
Yeah.
You know, and him staying healthy is a big consideration as well. Let's just quickly mention Dallas Goedert because he was maybe the number one prospect amongst tight ends in this year's class in the eyes of a lot of evaluators. He goes 49th. He's a backup now to Zach Ertz in Philadelphia, but we've seen this from Philly. Multiple tight ends can be useful in the course of a season. Last year, both Brent Celek and Trey Burton had their games. And as we saw last year, when Zach Ertz got hurt, Burton exploded. He became like a top six tight end during that time that Ertz was on the shelf. So Goedert, a name to keep in mind, perhaps the rare tight end handcuff if you do draft Zach Ertz early on in your 2018 redraft leagues. Any other names from this rookie draft class that stood out to you in any capacity? No kickers? Any long snapper breakdown?
No kickers. Love my Redskins draft, to be honest. Wanted Derwin James in the first, but I think Daron Payne's going to be a good pro. So I'm excited about Redskins.
Well, since we're talking about our teams, I like that they got somebody to protect handsome Jimmy.
There you go.
There you go.
Right.
Right, right away in the first round.
No, I mean, I can't. Well, I'm blanking on his name. The wide receiver from SMU that was Mr. Relevant that the Redskins picked. Like, a guy caught a ton of passes. A great slot
receiver.
Was it
Trey Quinn?
Yes, Trey Quinn. Thank you. I don't know why I just.
You know what's funny? I went to the combine, as we all did this year, but we all came back in time for the wide receiver workouts over the weekend. And they were going through the gauntlet at the time, which people might be familiar with it. A guy runs in a straight line, catches passes right and left, and I remember watching it with Chapin. She goes, Trey Quinn, like, dominated. She was like, all right, that guy's pretty good. Like, is he going to get drafted? And I was like, probably.
Yeah.
I was technically right.
Yeah, you know,
like,
you were.
Technically.
Caught a ton of passes, slot receiver. I just wonder, is he somebody that, not that you're going to draft, or just sort of a name to keep in mind, like, because Crowder is a free agent at the end of this year, and I could see them, if they felt like they got something out of Quinn and they proves himself, and depending on what Crowder wants, like, hey, you never know. You never know how that plays out. But Quinn was, I thought that was as good a Mr. Irrelevant pick as you could get.
I'm with you on that. By the way, as we mentioned earlier at the top of the show, plenty of content coming on throughout the week. The ESPN app, ESPN Plus, it's the Fantasy Summit. Before we go, and we will have an announcement Monday night, so if you're listening to the show on Tuesday, you may already know this news. Before we go, a quick best of luck to a good friend of the podcast, Joey Roberts.
Yeah.
Parting from ESPN. If you watched the draft on Saturday, you saw him actually on the air. He worked closely with Chris Mortensen and really the entire ESPN NFL team. Shefty, him, and Mort shared the set for a portion of Saturday. He's a great guy, close friend of all of ours here at the 06010. He's actually going to work in the new, I believe it's the American Alliance Football League, which is Bill Polian's prominently involved with.
Yep.
So let me just tell you this. If the name Joey Roberts comes up again at some point down the line as, like, team hires Roberts as GM, don't be surprised. Great guy, great football mind. We'll miss having him around.
Absolutely.
We are back on Thursday, I believe it is. It's the next time we are doing a podcast. It'll be a recap.
I thought it was Friday.
Friday, Thursday. I told you.
Whatever.
I think it's Thursday.
I think it is Friday this week. We will have a recap of all the Ranking Summit, where Field, Stefania, and I will explain how everyone else is wrong and our rankings are right.
That's
it will be a lot of fun.
That is correct.
It's one of my favorite podcasts of the year because I get to throw everyone else under the bus and they're not here to argue with me.
How is that different from any other day of the week?
It's a good point.
Good point, Stefania.
Every podcast is my favorite.
That. And on that note, we'll talk to you guys on Friday. In the meantime, Matthew Berry, TMR, and all forms of social media, except for the Fantasy Life app. He's just Matthew Berry. Stefania B87 on Instagram and Stefania _ESPN on Twitter. I'm at Field Yates everywhere. Talk to you guys on Friday.
Peace out!
The theme song of the Fantasy Focus was created and performed by Eric Hutchinson. Check out more of his music at erichutchinson.com. Thank you for listening to the Fantasy Focus Football Podcast. For more great podcasts, listen on the ESPN app or subscribe on iTunes.